This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Faith in the City: Preaching Radical Social Change in Detroit. Angela D. Dillard. With a foreword by Dr. Charles G. Adams. The University of Michigan Press, Ann Arbor. Foreword. By their institutions shall you know them. For the better part of my life, I have been a preacher and pastor. Therefore, I am intrigued, gratified, and most delighted by the subject, substance, and excellence of Dr. Angela Dillard's Faith in the City, Preaching Radical Social Change in Detroit. It is a refreshing and resourceful presentation of how private faith can serve effectively to create public institutions that act valiantly, impartially, and non-coercively to bring about positive and universal social change. Such religious activism as is described by Dr. Dillard as being responsible for the birth and rearing of organized labor unions, civil rights groups, and human rights institutions does not portray religion as loving and serving religion, but religion that is willing to pour out its life and energy into institutions and associations that serve the common good. In most instances of human progress in art, science, politics, and economics, there is the presence of the hidden, unselfish, altruistic, affirmative, loving, lifting, life-giving, freedom-directed hand of faith at work in the world to redeem and advance the interests of all humankind. James Luther Adams, late Harvard professor of Christian social ethics, used to say of churches, "By their institutions you shall know them." Professor Adams was paraphrasing a favorite Bible reference that was constantly quoted in every one of his sermons by the salient protagonist of this book, the late Reverend Dr. Charles Andrew Hill Sr. "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorns or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will know them by their fruits," Matt 7:15-20. If labor unions have served and still serve the public good, if such associations stem inordinate corporate greed and foster the reasonable and fair redistribution of wealth, if democracy is still being advanced, if the inclusive masses of people are benefited and sustained in a society that provides opportunity for all, requires responsibility from all, and builds a just community of all, Angela Dillard's book demonstrates and documents the good fruit that has been harvested from the social institutions that were spawned in, by, and through the churches in Detroit that encouraged, backed, and supported the birth of labor unions way back in the day when it was not popular, safe, or easy to do so. 65 or 70 years ago, three black pastors turned their backs on the rich automobile manufacturing companies that opposed the organization of labor unions and threw the weight of their faith and influence behind the movement to organize factory workers to protect their material interests by using the power and tools of collective bargaining. Corporate power resisted and violently opposed such a movement. There were rich corporate rewards for the pastors and churches that would discourage their laboring members from organizing. The majority of the pastors in Detroit, white and black, backed the owners and managers of the corporations and discouraged unionization. Charles A. Hill of Hartford Baptist Church, Malcolm Dade of St. Cyprian's Episcopal, Horace White of Plymouth Congregational, now Plymouth United Church of Christ, Henry Hitt Crane of Central United Methodist, and several others took an oppositional stance against corporate power and in favor of the laborers who, without unionization, had no power to protect themselves, advance themselves, or sustain their communities. Citing the evidence presented in this book, it can be brilliantly and successfully argued that without the life and work of religious faith, common people could not have organized themselves into effective institutions. How sweet it is that this book has arrived at such a critical time for religious institutions, particularly those that are located in the inner city. I look at my own city, and it is very evident that the downsizing of the automotive industry, the automation of manufacturing processes, the globalization of production and sales, the undermining of the labor movement, and the flight of jobs and the middle class from the city, coupled with the intensification of urban social problems, have created an economic crisis. Detroit is begging for economic development and an enlarged tax base to pay for public services and police protection. Our newest hotels are in trouble, as the occupancy rate is 50% or less. Cobo Hall, our newly expanded convention center, has been sparsely occupied. If massive numbers of new jobs are not created here, our future will soon be bleak. But Detroit does not stand alone. We see deterioration, decay, hopelessness, and despair all across the face of the United States. And I would venture to say that urban life worldwide is in crisis. Paris, London, and Rome are not the cities they used to be. And the church is being called upon to act as an instrument of transformation and hope. Two of the most precious hours of a sabbatical Merrill Fellowship that I had at Harvard Divinity School were spent in the company of my old and then very feeble retired professor, James Luther Adams, no relation to me, who wrote the book on being human religiously. I asked him, "Dr. Adams, will you please tell me what in your opinion is the hope of the world today?" And that sagacious, white-skinned, white-haired octogenarian looked me straight in the eye and said, "The hope of the world today is the African-American preacher." Now, I want to change that to African-American church, because I think that is what he meant to say. But can you imagine a white Harvard scholar who spent all his life, more than 90 years, in celebrated white institutions, in a white academic world of power and privilege, a man who has never wanted for any honor or distinction, saying to me that the hope of the world is not white wealth, not white culture, not white America, not white academic institutions, not the white Republican Party, not white corporate America, not General Motors, not IBM, not Harvard University with its multi-billion-dollar endowment? According to him, the hope of the world is none of these things that we respect and adore. He said that the hope of the world is the Black Church. It is a shocking statement both because of its source and because of its substance. As to its source, I would not have been surprised if these words came from a Black demagogue, charlatan, or perennial presidential candidate. Wouldn't you expect people like me to make such a cavalier and offhand assertion? Black preachers like me are often given to hyperbole, overkill, and media hype. All demagogues, politicians, and propagandists claim that they and their ethnic groups are the hope of the world, the source of a new world order. But this man is not a demagogue, he is too feeble. He is a seasoned, sober, reasonable Harvard scholar. And he said with no uncertain tone and no unexamined sense that the American African church is the hope of the world today. Now I know that means all colors because the color black includes all color and excludes none. But it's still a startling statement. Second, I am startled by the substance of the statement. How can we who have received the least be expected, even required, to give the most? Are we who are crucified by the world now to become its saviors? Are we who have been left out of the structures of power and privilege now to be the key that unlocks the door to freedom and power and liberty and justice for all? It seems absurd, doesn't it? Yet, perhaps the victims of society's injustice and indifference are the inevitable redeemers of the society that has rejected them. For when God was ready to build a new people to be the instruments of divine salvation, God chose not a yuppie or a buppy, but God chose those who were underprivileged, 100-year-old Abraham and a 90-year-old shriveled-up Sarah. God made them the mother and father of a holy nation. Then, when God was ready to draw Israel out of bondage in Egypt, God chose an 80-year-old, tongue-tied fugitive from justice named Moses and made him the first international leader and liberator in human history. As Gardner C. Taylor says, Moses left Egypt as a fugitive from justice, and Moses returned to Egypt as the prosecuting attorney. When God was ready to break the back of the British Empire, God chose not the armies and generals of Europe, but a thin, gaunt, brown, praying man of peace named Mahatma Gandhi, who crushed the largest, most far-flung, most impressive empire in the world not by military might, but by prayer and fasting. When God was ready to desegregate America, God chose as the leader not a privileged, preferred, pampered, and honored person, but a hated, rejected, despised, exploited, excluded, segregated, dishonored man named Martin Luther King Jr., and made him the greatest moral and spiritual leader of the 20th century. Does it take an exiled Moses to humanize and save a whole society? Does it take a blind Milton to see an invisible paradise? Does it take a deafened Beethoven to hear a humanly inaudible symphony of brotherhood and peace and write it down on paper? Does it take a once-excluded Maynard Jackson and Andrew Young to recreate the urban vitality of Atlanta? Does it take a Shirley Franklin to claim for Atlanta the written documentation of Martin King's legacy? Does it take a once-rejected Coleman Young to raise Detroit from pronounced social and economic death? Does it take an excoriated and vilified Harold Washington to transform Chicago politics? Does it take a crucified savior, a wounded healer, to redeem the world? And will it take ebony and ivory people of intelligence and spirituality and integrity to lift all of humanity to the light and life and love that should belong to all people? Since African Americans are in the intensive care ward of the U.S. economy, there is a tremendous opportunity for churches in general, and the African American church in particular, to initiate and demonstrate a better use of human and financial capital. White churches, like the Episcopal Diocese of Michigan and its McGee Fund for Urban Development, are stepping up to the plate and seeking to raise and invest much more in the inner cities as both a moral obligation and an economic opportunity. Likewise, Black churches must continue to merge across denominational lines to work in tandem with theological schools, universities, and business schools to conceive, implement, and complete an economic development plan not only for African Americans but for all of urban America. The Clinton economic stimulus plan went the way of all flesh. Republicans are in power but seem to be distracted by wars and rumors of wars. Corporate America is running away from the problem, but African Americans, working in tandem with other faith communities, could make a difference. African Americans grossed $800 billion last year. That is more than the gross national product of Canada and 15 other nations. A united church community could seek to garner 5% of that gross, not as gifts from individuals, but as investments made by individuals through an envisioned African American church community development fund. Expertly managed, such a fund could build factories, finance institutions, employ the indigent, solve social problems, educate youth, multiply and strengthen community-based banks, liberate and dignify the human race, and save and deliver children from drugs, crime, guns, gangs, violence, teenage pregnancy, and high school attrition to the end that the entire urban environment would be transformed. The church could take the lead because the church already has the human capital, the moral credibility, and the organizational skills to get things done. Is it not true that the African American church has given African Americans everything they have? An African American lawyer once told me, "I don't go to church because I think it has kept African Americans down." I said, "How ignorant can an intelligent man be? You need to read Carter G. Woodson's History of the Negro Church, E. Franklin Frazier's Negro Church in America, Garrow Wilmore's Black Religion and Black Radicalism, Eric Lincoln's African American Churches, Albert Rabaul's Slave Religion, Cornel West's Prophesied Deliverance, or Alden Morris's The Origins of the Civil Rights Movement. They all agree that everything we possess was mothered and nurtured by African American churches. Let me cite a few lines from Black Theology and Documentary History, edited by Garrow Wilmore and James H. Cohn. The Black church of the 19th century, despite its client relationship to white churches, was clearer about its identity than many of us are today. It knew itself to be God's judgment upon the inhumanity of racism. Its blackness was therefore an expression of its sense of cultural vocation. By every measure, it was an amazing institution, led for the most part by illiterate preachers, many of whom were slaves or recently freed men. Poverty-stricken and repressed by custom and law, this church converted thousands, stabilized family life, established insurance and burial societies, founded schools and colleges, commissioned missionaries to the far corners of the world, and at the same time, agitated for the abolition of slavery, supported illegal actions on behalf of refugees, organized the Underground Railroad, fulminated slave uprisings, promoted the Civil War, developed community, political, education, and action on behalf of civil rights, and provided the social, economic, political, and cultural base for the entire Black community in the United States. Everyone should know that the African Methodist Episcopal Church created and supported the first African-American university, Wilberforce, in 1858, predating emancipation. Everyone should know that Black Presbyterians, along with the white philanthropic response to their initiatives, created Johnson C. Smith University, which once had its own medical school, and also Knoxville College. Everyone should know the Black United Methodists created Gammon Theological Seminary, Houston Tillotson College, and many others. For their part, African American Baptists, working in tandem with the American Baptist Home Mission Society and Black Baptist State Conventions, established a Black college or university in every Southern state. In Alabama, it was Selma University. In Florida, it was Florida Memorial College. In North Carolina, it was Shaw University. In South Carolina, it was Benedict and Morris. In Virginia, it was Virginia Union. In West Virginia, it was Storer College. In Arkansas, it was Arkansas Baptist College. In Mississippi, it was what has now become Jackson State College. In Kentucky, it was Simmons University. In Tennessee, it was Roger Williams College, now Lemoyne Owen College. In Texas, it was Bishop College. In Louisiana, it was Leland College. And in Georgia, it was Morehouse and Spelman. Can't the churches do for economic development today what they did for educational opportunity 150 years ago? The African American church is all that African Americans have. It sits in the midst of our urban, ghettoized situation. Everyone in the ghetto does not belong to the church, but the church belongs to everybody in the ghetto. It is a preserver of our culture. It is a producer of our genius. It is the power base for political ascendancy. It is the parent of our music and art. It is the sponsor of our creativity, versatility, and ingenuity. It is the incubator of our leadership. It is the storehouse for the disinherited. It is the power base for the disfranchised, and it is a hospital for wounded souls. It is a love tabernacle for the hated and exploited. It is an open door to the least, the last, the lost, the little, the lowest, the unlucky, and the left out. It is the biggest enemy of the status quo. It is a central agency for anti-segregation and anti-defamation. It is a rock in a weary land of oppression. It is a shelter from the story blast of bigotry. It faces a frowning world and shouts and shows that we shall overcome. Let's join it, engage it, and use it to encourage African Americans and others to be partners, movers, and shakers in the vast underdeveloped vistas of economic possibility and social responsibility. Above all, churches must continually create new public services, voluntary associations, and advocacy institutions in order to fight to preserve affirmative action, labor unions, civil rights, and civil liberties. The Reverend Charles A. Hill admonished his church and the surrounding community to work tirelessly to build a better world and a just society. The institutions spawned by churches can serve the public good better and promote the general welfare best when they remain open to all, practically and religiously impartial. As Hill's prodigy and Dillard's pastor, I'm intrigued, gratified, and delighted by this book. It is a scholarly, well-documented, and thoroughly substantiated historical account of how the preaching and practice of faith in God served to create active, voluntary, inclusive secular associations of people who were motivated by their religious experiences, spiritual feelings, and doctrinal convictions to work hard in order to generate nonviolent, affirmative, socially inclusive changes in the city of Detroit and its suburbs. This book demonstrates and validates the power of the pulpit in public affairs. For many decades, the pulpits in Detroit have sounded forth the trumpet that has never known retreat, retrenchment, or retraction. White and Black, Jew and Gentile, Protestant and Catholic pastors of conservative or liberal inclinations have made all the difference in the formation of Detroit's unique character, diverse culture, and undying hope. St. Anselm used to say, "Fides quarens intellectum, faith seeks intelligence." But intelligence is not all that faith seeks. Faith also seeks radical change, collective righteousness, social equality, the unfettered opportunity to rise higher, both collectively and individually, and the courage to transform old systems of exclusion into open doors of opportunity. Faith perpetuates hope. Faith generates love. Faith actuates justice. Faith elucidates freedom as it lights the way for humankind to become a beloved community of all races, nations, and religions. It was a Harvard philosophy professor, Josiah Royce, who coined the phrase, beloved community, and inspired the intellectual consciousness of Martin Luther King Jr., who found in Royce's writings a powerful social commentary conceived from those Bible scriptures that articulate the demand of God for justice as a religious priority. The God of the Hebrew Bible and the Greek New Testament made justice, not personal piety, the ultimate priority. That God is love does not denigrate justice but necessitates it. Justice is the inevitable fruit, offspring, issue, and consequence of love. M. Scott Peck of blessed memory used to say that love is the active and determined and diligent search for and dedication to the total fulfillment and ultimate satisfaction of the beloved. To love is to be profoundly and indefatigably committed to the best interests of the beloved's life, liberty, justice, empowerment, and fulfillment. It is only puppy love, hound dog love, or purely undisciplined love that would deny justice for the sake of love. Such love that obstructs and violates and denies justice is not authentic love, but an imposter posing as something that is called love but falls far short of true love. It is because Angela Dillard unearthed the words and works of several Detroit activist pastors who truly understood the real nature of love as the basis of justice that her book presents compelling documentation that can fill out our historical comprehension and appreciation of dynamic faith in the life of the city. The author, her brilliant late brother, Father Paul Anthony Dillard, Dean of the Cathedral, Amani Temple, African American Catholic congregation, and I were blessed beyond measure to have been born and reared on the near west side of Detroit, whose earliest and most distinctive, dynamic, religious, cultural, and political center was Hartford Church, the birthplace of Ford's United Auto Workers Local 600. It was Charles Andrew Hill Sr., who delivered the baby Union into the life of the world. Charles Andrew Hill was born in Detroit on April 28, 1893. He was educated at Cleary Business College in Michigan and Lincoln University and Seminary in Pennsylvania. Having finished his social gospel studies and standard seminary work at Lincoln, Hill was elected by the congregation of Hartford Avenue Baptist Church to serve as its pastor. The congregation was composed of 35 intrepid souls. Pastor Hill assumed the pulpit in November 1920, and the church grew rapidly into one of the city's largest. Pastor Hill retired on his 75th birthday, on April 28, 1968, with a huge celebratory banquet that lauded our beloved pastor for his unequaled contribution to the advancement of his race, the uplift of humankind, and the enhancement of his native city. Talk about a profile of courage and imagination, Hill was Detroit's greatest. Angela Dillard raises Reverend Hill from dusty death and immortalizes his personality and power. Like the Apostle Paul, Hill did not preach about himself. He preached Christ, community, courage, and change. Before the present publication, we knew very few of the biographical details of Hill's birth, parentage, and rearing. We were unable to catalog his childhood experiences, choice of church, and call to ministry, or understand how he happened to be so radical, progressive, universal, relentless, and fearless in his pursuit of justice. He never cringed in the face of threats, or the massive opposition of and intimidation by the local, state, and federal governments. He loved his God, his church, his community, and his country. He loved America too much to leave it as he found it in 1893. I never met a human being so persistent and yet so cheerful, so Christ-like and nonviolent in his fearless fight for peace, equality, and universal inclusivity. In 1953, I saw what the government of the United States did to my pastor and mentor, the Reverend Charles A. Hill, how they hauled him in to testify before the House Committee on Un-American Activities, how he was condemned by the clergy, smeared in the media, and abandoned by many members of the church who feared the loss of jobs and fortunes. I sat in church that Sunday morning after seeing the televised hearings, which were meant to discredit and destroy this powerful, wonderful man, this organic intellectual and community leader. We wondered what Reverend Hill would say now. Would he continue the debate? Would he denounce the media? Would he castigate the government? Would he condemn his enemies by using the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God? No. His text that day was Matthew chapter 5 verse 43, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous." Obviously, Reverend Hill was inherently strong but totally non-hostile and non-violent, slow to anger and incapable of hate. He demonstrated a peaceful calm and confidence. He showed to the whole world the power of the love of God to change the world. The focus and joy of our religion is not brute power, but unconquerable love. 1 John chapter 4 verse 20 says, "If a man say I love God and hateth his brother or sister, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother or sister whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen?" The world needs the religious roots and social fruits of the spirit of Charles A. Hill Sr. There is an old black spiritual that asks the question, "As you got good religion?" Not just as you got religion, but is it good religion? There's a whole lot of dangerous, bad, sick religion in the world. Bad religion can make you hard, cold, mean, and insensitive. Bad religion is worse than no religion. I once heard the New Testament scholar Christer Stendahl say, "There's not an evil cause in the world that has not been sponsored by somebody's sick, perverted, bad, hateful religion." Bad religion spawned the medieval military crusades. Bad religion grabbed the enforcement of the state to destroy freedom of conscience. Bad religion set up the Inquisitions to enforce religious conformity. Bad religion murdered the Anabaptists, burned Joan of Arc at the stake, executed John Huss and Hans Denck, and persecuted and banished Roger Williams. Bad religion killed William Tyndale for translating the Bible into the vernacular of the people. Bad religion took apartheid to South Africa, brought slavery to America, fostered segregation, bigotry, and exploitation, organized the Ku Klux Klan, generated the Nazi Party, created the immoral majority, and produced Jim Jones, Jimmy Baker, Jimmy Swaggart, Jerry Falwell, and David Koresh. Bad religion assassinated Mahatma Gandhi, murdered Anwar Sadat, slew Indira Gandhi, cut up Lebanon, destroyed Iran, devastated Iraq, oppressed the poor, made September 11, 2001 a day of infamy, crucified Jesus, killed Martin Luther King Jr., and devastated Yugoslavia. That's why Grandma wanted to know, "As you got good religion?" Bad religion takes life. Good religion gives life. Bad religion castigates folks. Good religion liberates folks. Bad religion talks about national defense. Good religion talks about national purpose. Bad religion divides folks. Good religion unites folks. Bad religion makes you hate folks. Good religion makes you love everybody. Bad religion segregates. Good religion integrates. Bad religion stays in the church. Good religion breaks loose in the world. Bad religion hangs around the altar. Good religion walks down the Jericho road with healing in its hands. Bad religion is shaped like a spurious pole, trying to reach up to God without reaching out to anybody. Good religion is shaped like a cross, the vertical beam reaching up to God for power, and the horizontal beam reaching out to people and sharing love, power, peace, joy, hope, life, freedom, jobs, education, and opportunity all around. As you got good religion? When we get good religion, true religion, strong religion, inclusive religion, we will not be discouraged by anyone, defeated by anything, destroyed by any evil. I believe that Angela Dillard's book promotes good religion and authentic faith, and for that I am both grateful and very proud. Dr. Charles G. Adams, Pastor, Hartford Memorial Baptist Church, Detroit, Michigan. 1. Evolving Faith. Reverend Charles A. Hill and the Making of a Black Religious Radical. In the short story, Fire and Cloud, published in the 1940 collection Uncle Tom's Children, African-American writer Richard Wright explores the conflicts among religion, politics, race, and class by focusing on the inner turmoil and external pressures besetting Reverend Taylor, the story's protagonist. The tale commences with Reverend Taylor, a black minister in a small southern town, returning from a discouraging meeting with the town's white relief officer. Taylor had gone, hat in hand, to plead the case of the town's nearly destitute and increasingly desperate black population. He was rebuffed, told only that everybody's hungry, and after all, it's no harder on your people than it is on ours. The officer's only suggestion is that Taylor tell his congregation, they'll just have to wait. Mulling over how best to convey the bad news, Taylor begins to think, Lord, maybe them reds is right, which is to say, maybe the community should band together, stage a massive interracial march downtown, and scare them into doing something. At the same time, Taylor is worried that such a militant course of action would offend the mayor and the town's white elite, endangering his flock and the entire black community by stirring up the antagonism of local whites. It would also, he fears, place his own position as minister of his church in jeopardy, especially since Deacon Smith, a black snake in the grass, a black Judas, is looking for any excuse to engineer Taylor's ouster. By the time Taylor arrives at his home, all of these pressures and worries and competing constituencies have been gathered under one roof, literally. The Reds, Hadley and Green, are in the Bible room. The chief of police, who has been sent by the mayor, is in the parlor. Deacon Smith, who has been using the rumor of a demonstration in his campaign to discredit Taylor and curry favor with the local white political bosses, is in the basement with the other deacons, and a distressed and agitated delegation from his congregation is crowded into the front hallway. The physical structure of the house, then, operates as a symbolic representation of Reverend Taylor's internal conflicts, conflicts that are resolved when Taylor is abducted and savagely beaten by a gang of white men, after which he agrees to support the interracial march. In preparation for that march, Wright has Taylor preach an uncompromising sermon, urging his audience to take collective action on its own behalf. Sisters and brothers, I know now. I done seen the sign. Wes gotta get together. I know what your life is. I done felt it. It's fire. It's like the fire that burned me last night. It's suffering. It's hell. I can't bear this fire alone. I know now what to do. Wes gotta get close to one or another. God's done spoke. God's done sent his sign. Now it's time Ferris T-Ack. Characteristically, Wright leaves the question of the march's success unanswered. We are not told whether the black and white marchers, united at least for the moment around shared class interests, are able to force the hand of the town's elite. While he suggests that all of the participants, especially the African-American ones, have been transformed by the experience of interracial collective struggle, Wright ends with Taylor's newfound conviction that this is the way. God ain't no lie, he tells himself, and the story concludes as he mumbled out loud, exultingly, freedom belongs to the strong. This story of one religious man's, one minister's, conversion to the necessity of collective action is instructive for a number of reasons, not the least of which is Wright's ability to capture the complex relationship of faith to action. At the beginning of the tale, the sympathetic Taylor is a man of God, whose authority as a minister anoints him a mediator between the black community and the white power structure. Sustained by his faith, he accommodates himself to the racial and class status quo, viewing his passivity as the only viable option in a town and a world where the white folks jew about owns everything. At the story's end, Taylor's faith continues to shape his identity and his actions, but now those actions are geared toward a non-accommodationist and potentially progressive politics. What has changed is Taylor's interpretation of what God demands and his vision of how best to serve his congregation. Reverend Taylor had many real-life counterparts in the Depression era, ministers who, like Taylor, were driven by faith and circumstance to participate in mass demonstrations, strikes, and other political actions. Progressive activists and unionists in Detroit in the 1930s and early 1940s were blessed with the presence of three such men, the Reverend Horace A. White, Father Malcolm C. Dade, and the Reverend Charles A. Hill. All three played a key role in the city's early civil rights movement, and all three are intriguing in their own right. It was the Reverend Hill, however, who developed the most extensive and militant set of positions and alliances with the left, and whose story therefore seems the most compelling. His biography embodies the dynamic confluence of religion and politics during the formative years of Detroit's early civil rights community. Charles Hill did not start as a radical in either a political or a theological sense. In fact, he was once described as an old-fashioned Bible-thumping preacher whose only political concern was making things right in the sight of the Lord. This wonderfully descriptive statement from Hill's close friend and ally, Coleman A. Young, the labor radical who became Detroit's first black mayor in 1973, captures the intriguing admixture of conservative and progressive uses of religion that formed the beating heart of Hill's political theology and activism. Like the fictional Reverend Taylor, there was nothing particularly radical about Hill's understanding of evangelical Christianity. Unlike the radical theologians active in the 1930s, figures such as Claude Williams and Harry Ward, one of the founding members of the Methodist Federation for Social Action, Hill never articulated a direct connection between Christianity and Marxism, nor did he ever directly urge the overthrow of capitalism. And yet this Bible-thumping minister became one of the most militant religious leaders in the city. Reverend Hill was not a practicing theologian, and unfortunately few of his writings and sermons survived his death in 1970. Yet Hill's early life and young adulthood offer a number of clues to the sources of his later political activism. Born in Detroit on April 28, 1893, Hill was the surviving twin born to Edward Hill, an African-American dentist, and Mary Lance Hill, a second-generation German-American. There are two family stories or legends about this union. The first, told by Hill's eldest son, Charles A. Hill Jr., maintains that the union was little more than a one-night stand. Edward Hill had come to town for a convention, you know, and Mary Lance was a waitress, I think, at a local place. They met and, well, one thing led to another. The other version, told by Hill's daughter, Bermisha Morrow McCoy, insists that Mary Lance and Edward Hill were formally married, even though there is no trace of a marriage license or official record. She also points out that Mary Lance went by the name Mrs. Hill until her death. In both heavily gendered versions, Edward and Mary defied the racial and sexual norms that structured social interactions in what was then still a small city, teetering on the brink of industrial greatness. Although an 1838 statute prohibiting marriage between blacks and whites had been repealed by the Michigan legislature in 1882, the social stigma attached to such a union at the time of Hill's birth would have been substantial. And while blacks were scattered across the German East Side, virtually no intermarriages were officially recorded before the early 1900s. The union between Mary and Edward may not have been prohibited by the state, but it was certainly not sanctioned by members of the Lance family, who, like many other older German immigrants, had become relatively prosperous as skilled workers. As a result of the unpopular marriage, illicit rendezvous, Mary was forced to sever her familial ties. Whatever the truth about the nature of their relationship, it ended, but not before a child was conceived. There is no evidence as to whether Edward Hill ever saw his son or provided any type of emotional or financial support for his estranged wife and child. In fact, Hill's birth certificate lists his father as unknown. Apparently, Edward Hill returned to Chicago. According to both Hill children, Charles Hill rarely mentioned his father. Both children also agree that the two men never met. For his mother, however, Charles Hill seemed to harbor only love and affection. Mary Hill's life was not an easy one. She was left alone with a red-headed infant who in his third month began to darken, much to the consternation of her friends and neighbors in the German community near J Street and Gratiot on Detroit's East Side. His birth certificate lists him as white, but this did not stop gossip about Mary's colored baby from spreading through the community and compounding the hardships faced by the young, ostensibly single mother. Eking out a living for herself and her child, without a strong support network in turn-of-the-century Detroit soon proved overwhelming. Shortly after Charles was baptized into the Catholic faith, Mary Hill took the drastic step of placing her son in the care of an orphanage, the German Protestant home, where he would remain for the next 11 to 12 years. That she was able to place her colored baby in the home was fairly remarkable in itself, since nearly all of the city's orphanages practiced a policy of racial exclusivity. In fact, in a June 1916 exchange of letters between the Reverend John Webster, superintendent of the German Protestant home, and Forrester B. Washington, the first director of the Detroit Urban League, DUL, Webster reported that "we have never had any colored children in our home and had none presently." Throughout her son's tenure as a ward, Mary continued to work odd jobs, taking in laundry and hiring herself out as a maid, and visited Charles sporadically. Aware of his ambiguous status as both son and orphan, not to mention as both legally white and socially colored, his years at the German Protestant home passed slowly. As an adult, Hill rarely mentioned these years. The one story that his eldest son was able to clearly recall had to do with Hill sneaking into the cellar of the orphanage to lick the sides of the maple syrup barrels. While humorous, Charles Hill Jr. remembers this as a story of deprivation. Although Charles Sr.'s love for and loyalty to Mary Hill was never questioned by friends or family, there is little doubt that he was deeply affected by his experience in both negative and positive ways. "I think that's why Daddy was such a good father," Bermisha recalled. "I mean, not having a father, and the orphanage, made him value fatherhood that much more. But the implications of his years in the orphanage extend even further. On the one hand, his early and prolonged exposure to white children and administrators may have accounted in part for his later ease in interracial and majority white settings. Perhaps it even formed the basis for his abiding faith in the possibility of integration and racial reconciliation. If a much later remark by his grandson, David Morrow, is accurate, then Hill found a certain amount of acceptance and support at the home. During his early years, Morrow said in a speech entitled, "Charles Andrew Hill, the Family Man," delivered at his grandfather's retirement celebration in 1968, his teachers in the home recognized his strong character and depended on him to escort them to and from evening prayer service. On the other hand, it is surely the case that his early experiences complicated Hill's efforts to work out his own racial or interracial identity. By his 11th or 12th year, Hill had had enough. He returned to his mother's house on J Street, determined to assist her and continue his education. The character of the J Street neighborhood, like the city as a whole, had begun to change. J Street was still part of the area near Gratiot Avenue populated by less affluent Germans, but by 1905 the area also included the better class of the colored people, as well as Jewish families. Naturally, he would have explored his new surroundings as he traveled from home to school to whatever after-school jobs he could secure to augment the relatively meager family income. West of Gratiot, near the heart of what had been known as Little Berlin, was Woodward Avenue, the broad main boulevard that bisected the city, stretching from the river outward past Detroit's ever-expanding northern boundaries. To the far east lay Dequindre Avenue, with an ethnic and racial patchwork in between. Detroit's near east side, the center of Hill's geographical existence, was the traditional point of entry for immigrant Detroit, first for the French, then for relatively fewer Irish, and later for innumerable Germans. In the 1880s and 1890s, it became the portal for immigrant Italians, who established a colony near the river called Paradise Valley, and for Greeks, Jews, and waves of Poles, who would quickly become the largest cultural minority group in the city. By the turn of the century, the Deep East Side was identified with Irish, Gratiot with Germans, Hastings Street with Poles and Russian Jews, and Paradise Valley with Italians. The narrow sector to the south of Jefferson, the major avenue following the contours of the Detroit River, was filled with dilapidated old warehouses, decaying housing stock, vice, crime, and the poor from all racial and ethnic groups. In a pattern that was replicated generation after generation, each group would establish a beachhead within the east side and gradually move out and up, socioeconomically speaking, generally toward the city's northern reaches. This is what the better-off, native-born white population managed to do as Detroit experienced its first major population boom, from 132,956 residents in 1884 to 205,876 in 1890. The last group to manage this transition in class and social space would be African Americans, who occupied more and more of the East Side as others moved on. In the early 1900s, when Hill first encountered it, this African American enclave was still relatively small. Before the Civil War, the tiny black population of roughly 580 souls had been clustered in the area between Randolph Street on the west, Hastings on the east, Gratiot on the north, and the river to the south. By the 1870s, blacks, who made up less than 3% of the population, began to settle in the old Kentucky district, 20 blocks north of Gratiot in St. Antoine and throughout the East Side. As the Black population increased, from 4,111 in 1900 to 5,741 in 1910, so did its concentration, creating the early outlines of what would soon become a city within a city, with a variety and breadth of institutions that could match those of Detroit itself. Mary Hill gradually withdrew from friends and neighbors in the years following her son's return, but she never stood in the way of Charles's desire for increased interaction with African Americans. Indeed, she would periodically accompany him to the various Black churches that he attended, faithfully, every Sunday. Her own ties to Catholicism and the local parish had weakened over the years, and she did not prevent her son from exploring other religious options. Hence, Hill was free throughout his high school years to frequent no less than three churches: Ebenezer African Methodist Episcopal, AIM, Bethel AIM at the corner of Napoleon and Hastings, and Second Baptist, the oldest of the city's Black churches, with a stately brick edifice on Monroe originally called Croghan Street. It was largely through these religious institutions that Hill came to identify with the struggles, hopes, successes, and indignities that were part of the day-to-day existence of Detroit's Black population. Indeed, it is difficult to underestimate the importance of Black churches in urban centers during this period. They were often the first institutions to provide social services, and they offered spaces for meetings and gatherings, both spiritual and secular. Moreover, they endowed their congregants with a sense of belonging, a source of stability in a chaotic world. These institutions also arguably augmented Hill's understanding of class stratification. In Detroit, as elsewhere, church membership was an excellent measure of class and social status within the Black community. Hence, it is significant that Hill did not seem to have much contact with churches such as St. Matthew's Episcopal, at the intersection of St. Antoine and Elizabeth, which catered to the Black elite, particularly the city's small group of established Black families. The St. Matthew's congregation included doctors and lawyers, and was always led by well-educated clergymen. There was widespread acknowledgement that the church's ornate chapel was the most popular site of worship for members of the Blue Book of Colored Society in Detroit, and the parish actively cultivated its reputation among those who fancy themselves to the intelligentsia and the better-paid workmen and businessmen. This tendency shaped much of the church's history. In an internal document, A Brief History of St. Matthew's Church, probably drafted in the early 1920s, the anonymous author makes repeated reference to the upstanding, courageous, intelligent, high-type class of men who played a role in the establishment and maintenance of the church in its early years. Among this group were men who had been free since birth and whose ancestors before them had been free. These men are mentioned not only because of their accomplishments, the author relates, but also because we believe it to be a just and Christian act to dissipate the impression of illiteracy of the men of that time. Along with the high type of the congregation and the impressive education of the clergy, the typewritten history also notes, "Our splendid contacts with the best and most influential citizenry of the white race has always worked for the best interests of our group, as in the past this fact is still apparent." This fact was also apparent throughout the first half of the 20th century, especially as the church continued to enjoy contacts with Henry Ford and others. Thus, under the direction of Robert W. Bagnall from 1911 to 1921, when Bagnall left to become the NAACP's director of branches in New York and FR Everard Daniel, until 1939, St. Matthew's membership strove to be a group conscious of their role as community leaders and separate from the masses of the laboring classes. It was to those laboring classes that Hill, the son of a working-class mother, was drawn. Eschewing the cachet of St. Matthew's, Hill favored churches such as Bethel AIM, whose congregants were from the middling classes, factory workers, carpenters, tailors, janitors, laundresses, and cooks, and Second Baptist, which also had a predominantly working-class congregation. Bethel was a driving force behind Detroit's Black institutional development in the late 19th century. It was particularly active in the field of education and was the first church to do extensive social work among the Black population. It was in such institutions, moreover, that Hill found an edifying religious emotionalism to match the evangelical style that he would come to adopt in his own preaching decades later. but that is not all that he found. Members of all three congregations became his friends, their respective pastors became mentors and role models, perhaps becoming the extended family and father figures he had never had. Hill was particularly drawn to the children of these congregations. By the time he entered his final year of high school, he had managed to have himself appointed superintendent of the Sunday schools at Bethel and Second Baptist while serving on the usher board at Ebenezer. It was during these years of immersion in Black religious life that Hill began to struggle with the question of whether he truly felt the call of the ministry, that urge to preach as a vocation that is so central to African American and Christian religious expression. In narratives of the call experience, conflict, resistance, and uncertainty are tropes of the struggle to understand and answer. Those who are called to the ministry often have to come to terms with feelings of inadequacy, loneliness, and doubt about their competence to fulfill a religious vocation. Hill's experiences fit this arc. His devotion was strong, yet he remained uncertain. The idea of becoming a minister competed with dreams of pursuing a career in law or business. With high school graduation swiftly approaching, Hill chose business. He was wary of leaving home, and the family finances were as precarious as ever, but with his mother's blessing, he headed to Ypsilanti, Michigan, to attend Cleary Business College, where he earned a degree in business administration. Cleary was a relatively good vocational school. It was predominantly white, but not racially exclusive. Moreover, and perhaps more important, it was close enough to Detroit, about 30 miles, that Charles could return home nearly every weekend to continue his Sunday school and other church duties. The short bus ride home every Friday or Saturday also gave him the opportunity to visit with his mother. She never failed to prepare his favorite foods or to hand wash and press a stack of white shirts so that he would look presentable throughout the week. He did well in his courses. His transcripts reveal a very basic selection of classes top-heavy with arithmetic, bookkeeping, and office practices. As Hill struggled to blend the secular world of weekday business studies with the spiritual world of the church, he also continued to wrestle with the question of whether he felt truly called to preach and minister. His chosen path reflects this doubt and struggle. Hill finished Cleary in 1912, and accepted an apprenticeship in the downtown offices of Black attorney William Patrick Sr. with the intent of pursuing a legal career. At the same time, he enrolled in a correspondence course offered by Moody Bible College in Chicago. This dichotomy is significant for at least two reasons. First, Hill's actions reveal the extent to which he was conflicted over the call and his future. Second, his choice of Moody tells us something about how Hill conceptualized the role of a minister. Named in honor of Dwight L. Moody, a 19th-century evangelist who operated schools for Bible work in the slums of Chicago for 16 years, Moody Bible College was not a traditional seminary. Rather, the institution was in many ways the perpetuation of Dwight Moody's desire to outfit laymen for the practical work of reaching the masses. This appreciation for the practical side of the ministry would mark Hill's long career. He also adopted much of Moody's theological framework, which was conservative and evangelical. Hill was comfortable with fairly literal scriptural readings and interpretations. He was not a theologian in the scholarly sense, and not surprisingly, he chose to take the Bible doctrine course, ultimately receiving a degree in the doctrine of God, the doctrine of Jesus Christ, the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, the doctrine of man, and the doctrine of angels and Satan. As a field of theological inquiry, it seems to have emphasized the place of mankind after the Trinity, and to have regarded Satan as a real presence in the world. This type of theological conservatism is not inconsistent with a radical politics, and it had the potential, realized in Hill's later work, to fuel a forthright critique of capitalism, racism, and exploitation. Hill's degree from Moody also gave him credentials sufficient to enroll in the seminary at Lincoln University in rural Chester, Pennsylvania. On the eve of World War I, he matriculated as a probationary student. Lincoln was an all-Black and all-male college funded by the Presbyterian Church and endowed with a reputation for producing outstanding graduates. The Black Princeton, as it was known, was an ideal site for ambitious and upwardly mobile young Black men, many of whom would go on to become doctors, lawyers, businessmen, and of course, ministers. Religion played a major role in the founding and running of the school. When Lincoln was founded in 1854, its primary mission was to oversee the Christian education of black men and prepare them to evangelize in both the United States and Africa. By the time of Hill's arrival in 1914, this mission had become broader and much more secular overall. Simply put, the impetus to evangelize became wedded to and perhaps submerged within the drive to uplift socially, economically, and politically. Moreover, as one of the first institutions dedicated to higher learning for African Americans, Lincoln's administrators eschewed the Tuskegee-inspired trend toward industrial education. Instead, they chose a path that would make their university a leading example of an institution devoted to the creation of W.E.B. Du Bois' talented 10th. The talented 10th ideal is often derided, in some cases rightfully so, as mere elitism. As historian Kevin Gaines points out, this emphasis on class differentiation as race progress could produce distressing results. Amid the legal and extra-legal repression, he argues, many black elites sought status, moral authority, and recognition of their humanity by distinguishing themselves as bourgeois agents of civilization from the presumably undeveloped black majority. Hence the phrase, so purposeful and earnest, yet so often of ambiguous significance, uplifting the race. This is not to suggest that racial uplift was completely devoid of positive features. Indeed, uplift was also rooted in a tradition of service and social responsibility, and each one teach one understanding of collective struggle and social emancipation. When underpinned by religious faith, particularly the desire to see to it that others were right with God, uplift focused on both this world and the next. Such a call to service shaped Hill's life and career. It had been inculcated years ago in the churches he joined as an adolescent, cultivated during his years at Lincoln, and fully expressed in his ministry at Hartford, whose motto was, "We gather to worship, we depart to serve." The Lincoln experience seemed to shape Hill in other ways as well. Its diverse student body afforded him the opportunity to interact with young men from different geographical regions. Because of Lincoln's continuing commitment to training African students, he also met students from different countries. The entering class of 1917, for example, was almost evenly divided between men from southern states, especially Georgia, and northern ones, especially Pennsylvania. The student body was also socioeconomically diverse. The administration kept tuition low and often allowed students to graduate with debt. While this policy would eventually prove disastrous from an administrative and financial standpoint, it gave financially insecure students such as Hill the chance to receive a first-rate liberal arts-based education. Lincoln had an all-black student body, but until 1930, its faculty was exclusively white. It was also a non-reformist institution that sought to minimize militant attitudes and maintain a low profile in the region. Relatively conservative in outlook, the administration struggled to articulate the potentially non-conservative goal of educating a black elite in neutral terms. Thus, the students relied on one another to collectively negotiate the ambiguities at the heart of the institution. The faculty, while charged with the responsibility of cultivating a group of exceptional black men capable of redeeming their race, tended to remain aloof from students both socially and ideologically. By all accounts, racial equality and racial justice, national and international, were rarely discussed in the classrooms, where strict decorum was maintained at all times. This neglect of pressing racial issues, coupled with the social distance between students and faculty, surely helped to encourage the creation of an extracurricular culture of evening bull sessions and informal debates on such topics as national and international politics, the Black Rights Agenda, the war, and colonialism. Copies of Black publications, such as the NAACP's Crisis magazine, were circulated and discussed among students, and the need for heightened militancy in the struggle for equality was always a topic of conversation. A religious sensibility was also pervasive at Lincoln, both inside and outside the seminary, where Hill was enrolled. In keeping with the school's heritage, all students were required to take 2 academic semesters of religious studies, and attendance at weekly chapel services was mandatory. In this regard, Lincoln was part of the mainstream of Black education, in which all education was to some degree religious. According to Horace Mann Bond, a Lincoln graduate who became the college's first Black president in 1945, the university was constructed on a set of well-defined religious principles. Lincoln University, he wrote, is a spiritual, intellectual, and social institution. Its basic theme derives from the idea that there is but one God. A monotheistic religion, principally the handiwork of the Jews, has the necessary corollary that God is the Father of all mankind, the children of God are brothers. The fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of all mankind are concepts whose deeper meaning and significance exceed their prima facie simplicity. If, as the Bible insists, God is no respecter of persons, and all men and women are equal in his eyes, then racial prejudice and social intolerance are necessarily sinful and immoral. All the available evidence about Hill's style of preaching and ministering to his flock, not to mention his broader political theology, shows that this ethos infused his life and work. He preached the Bible, as his son put it. He was also holistic in his theological view, recalled the Reverend Charles G. Adams, who grew up in Hartford, was mentored by Hill, and assumed the pastorate of the church when Hill retired. He was very cosmopolitan and universalistic. This universalism, or religious ecumenicalism, is hardly surprising given that Hill was baptized Catholic, raised at a German Protestant orphanage, prayed at both AIM and Baptist churches, and graduated from a Presbyterian seminary. This same ecumenical spirit extended to his later political associations. Hill's seminary training was strict and traditional. Basic requirements would have included coursework in biblical archaeology, homiletics, systematic theology, apologetics, Old Testament exegesis, pastoral theology, and expression. Like many of his classmates, he no doubt came to Lincoln with his own ideas, many of which had been formed through his experiences, especially in Black churches, and in his correspondence course at Moody, about the Bible, Christianity, and their place in the world. In Hill's case, these ideas translated into a brand of Christianity that demanded activism in society on behalf of the oppressed, the underdog, which is a classic expression of both the social gospel and the prophetic strain within African American Christianity. This is not to suggest that either the social gospel or prophetic Christianity was part of the Lincoln curriculum, but certainly students were free to work out their own understandings of the relationship between these traditions and the theology they studied in the classroom. At the time of Hill's tenure at Lincoln, most of the faculty were either Presbyterian clergymen or laymen, many of whom had trained at Princeton. The seminary's orientation was therefore toward a blend of Calvinism and religious humanism. If the humanist idea that all men and women are equal in the eyes of the Lord formed one pillar of religious education at Lincoln, then the Calvinist doctrine of election, the idea that God has chosen a particular group of people for a particular destiny, and that salvation comes through grace not works, formed the other. This doctrine of election and salvation not only conformed to the university's missionary outlook, it also offered a religious justification for the notion of a talented tenth that would go forth and uplift the race. Hill imbibed this spirit as he worked out his own political theology. At its heart, this theology can best be thought of in terms of the evangelical liberalism constructed by serious Christians, searching for a theology that could be believed and embraced by intelligent moderns. This evangelical liberalism was both Christ-centric and biblically based. It was Christ-centric to the degree that it expressed the essential features of Christianity, the person and work of Jesus Christ as Savior, in terms suitable to a modern world plagued with the social sins of racism and exploitation. And it was biblically based insofar as the scriptural teachings were accepted because of their intrinsic worth and epistemological value. Even during these years, roughly 1914 to 1918, glimmers of Hill's affinity for evangelical liberalism can be seen, whether in his volunteer service as secretary of the Young Men's Christian Association's YMCA's National War Work Council, or in his pursuit of an advanced teaching certificate through the Pennsylvania Sunday School Association. The Sunday School movement has, after all, always been part of a broader evangelical mission. After 4 years of wrestling with theological concepts inside the classroom and debating racial politics with his fellow students after hours, Hill was prepared to begin his career as a licensed minister. His mixture of Bible-thumping evangelism and social activism was already in evidence. Selected to give one of the commencement addresses for the graduation of the class of 1918, Hill chose the provocative title, Religion, A Man's Job. Sadly, the text of the speech has not survived. He and many of his classmates listening that afternoon had foregone military service, a major expression of Black manhood at the time. But perhaps they saw themselves as soldiers of a different kind, as young men able and willing to do the man's job of ministering to the faithful and pressing the cause of Black rights. Like their counterparts returning from the war, Hill and his classmates were no doubt inspired by what many took to be a new and growing African-American militancy. During the war, W.E.B. Du Bois had echoed the sentiments of many when he advised Blacks to close ranks around the country and engage in patriotic, albeit segregated, service. Now, at war's end and with segregation unabated, he proclaimed, "We return. We return from fighting. We return fighting. Make way for democracy. We saved it in France, and by the great Jehovah, we will save it in the United States of America, or know the reason why." Hill would have surely seen himself as one of Du Bois' soldiers of democracy. He would have also seen himself as one of the new Negroes. The same generation that would discover newness all round itself, new humanism, new thought, new woman, new criticism, would also discover a new Negro. As Asa Philip Randolph, then editor of The Messenger, billed as the only radical Black socialist magazine in America, put it at the time, the new Negro arrived on the scene at the same time of all the other forward progressive movements. A product of both war and migration, this new Negro was, or so many claimed, no longer willing to turn the other cheek, while his political rights were ignored and trampled, his labor exploited, and his demands for social equality and social justice mocked. Black Americans, declared Alon Locke some years later, were no longer willing to be something to be argued about, condemned or defended, to be kept down or in his place or helped up, to be worried with or worried over, harassed or patronized, a social bogey or a social burden. Although this new Negro was partially the product of artists, intellectuals, and middle-class activists, it was not without a material basis in the changing everyday lives of large segments of the African-American population. The beginning of the Great Migration, from rural to urban and south to north and west, was an important expression of agency and self-determination, as millions of African-Americans struck out in search of better lives for themselves and their children. The scattered outbreaks of anti-Black violence that greeted the appearance of this new Negro, especially during the Red Summer of 1919, are one indication that white communities across the country felt the need to keep Blacks, new or not, in their subordinate places. When some of the soldiers came from World War I, Hill recalled, they had gotten used to larger privileges and so they were making a demand and being pushy. And Hill, who pledged to take up the man's job of religion during this sickening wave of anti-Black violence, was in favor of pushiness. In the midst of the celebration of the new Negro and the concomitant racial violence, Hill returned home to Detroit and was ordained in the Baptist faith. Although Detroit escaped the outbreak of a full-fledged race riot, there were a number of clashes between Blacks and whites, especially during the spring of 1919, as the post-war recession led to a more competitive job market. Periodic violence at the factory gates, particularly when Black workers were used as strikebreakers and scabs, also helped to keep racial tension high. Moreover, the bombing of homes as a means of forcing Blacks out of previously integrated neighborhoods and preventing new arrivals, which had begun as early as 1917, became frequent by 1920. But Hill returned not only to a city of increasing racial tensions and violence. He also returned to his mother's J Street house and one of the churches, Second Baptist, that had provided him with a spiritual home. Accepting a position as assistant pastor, Hill benefited from a familiarity with the congregation's older members that came from his being a former member and Sunday school superintendent. Less familiar were the church's newcomers, the steady flow of Black Southern migrants who had been arriving in the city since the beginning of World War I. Detroit had become one of the leading destinations for Black workers migrating out of the South in search of work. Between 25 and 35,000 African American migrants took up residence there in 1916 and 1917 alone, meaning remarkably that the majority of the city's Black population, which numbered over 40,000 in 1920, had arrived in that 1 year. A second wave of migration in 1924 and 1925 brought an additional 40,000 men, women, and children. By 1926, 85% of Detroit's Black population had arrived in just one decade. At the same time, the city's total population also doubled, making it the fourth largest city in America by 1920. While astonishing in their own right, these numbers fail to reveal the energy and hope, as well as the misery and despair, that gripped the city's residents in the immediate post-World War I period. For some, there was a sense that the city was on the move. New industries, especially the automotive industry, were in a period of intense growth. But for others, especially the majority of the city's southern migrants, both Black and white, the promised land turned out to be a hell of poverty and social dislocation. Many Black migrants watched their dreams slowly die in the 34 crowded city blocks that comprise Paradise Valley, the old Italian East Side enclave where the vast majority of the Black population was confined from the 1920s to the 1940s. Under the pastorate of Reverend Robert Bradby, Second Baptist had welcomed these troubled newcomers from the start. From 1915 to 1920 alone, over 900 new members were added to the church's rolls. Hill owed his position as assistant pastor in charge of charity and educational programs to the influx. Given that so many Black Southern migrants were Baptist, the church automatically benefited from the increase. But Bradby was also dedicated to outreach. In 1917, he set up a system of committees to meet the trains arriving at Michigan Central Station with offers of housing and employment assistance. As an assistant pastor, Hill was thrown into the thick of the Black community's social crisis, where housing and jobs were the most pressing concerns. The district on the city's Lower East Side that young Charles had explored as a teenager was now bursting at the seams. In 1918, 12 to 15,000 African American residents were crowded into 3 square miles that had previously housed half that number. Although a number of other smaller districts had been developed, the high-rent, poverty-ridden East Side would remain the city's chief point of entry for migrants for decades. Excessive rents, as much as 50 to 60% higher than what whites and white ethnics were paying in other parts of the city, coupled with lower-paying, unskilled jobs, posed enormous difficulties for Southern migrants. One of Hill's duties was to assist new migrants in finding adequate housing and decent jobs. While the assistant pastor no doubt considered this part of the man's job of religion in action, it was actually a job in which women, most notably the church's big sister auxiliary, played the dominant role. In less than 4 years, this group of 100 women had recruited hundreds of volunteers, raised over $5,000, and founded a home for young women that was to stand as a beacon light for the protection of our girls. The women of Second Baptist, along with other church women and club women in the city, expended thousands of hours in charity work, organizing groups and societies to tend to the needs of Black Southern migrants. Second Baptist was thus a prominent place for a young, newly ordained minister to begin his career. Founded in 1836 after the First Baptist congregation split over allowing its Black congregants to vote in church matters, Second Baptist is the oldest Black church not only in Detroit but in the entire state. Second Baptist has a long and proud history of going beyond the spiritual needs of the congregation and extending itself into politics and social life. The church was a stop on the Underground Railroad. One can still see the basement rooms used to hide fugitive slaves and hosted Frederick Douglass and John Brown. Reverend Bradby was a distinguished leader of this important institution. Born into poverty in a rural area outside Chatham, Ontario, a background that might explain his tremendous sympathy for Southern migrants, Bradby was schooled at McMaster University, a Baptist college and seminary in Toronto. Before accepting the pastorate at Second Baptist in 1910, he had served congregations in Amherstburg and Windsor, Ontario, and Toledo, Ohio. A self-made man and prominent religious leader, Bradby was a good role model for the young minister Hill. Hill did not remain in the position for long, however. In 1920, he married Georgia Roberta Underwood, the daughter of a Seventh-day Adventist minister. Born in Longsport, Indiana, Georgia had lost both parents by the age of 10 and was sent to live with an aunt in Ann Arbor, Michigan, where she met Hill at a convention of Sunday school teachers and administrators. Georgia Underwood Hill was a deeply religious convert to the Baptist faith. As a young woman, she had once vowed that she would never be a minister's wife and would never live in Detroit. Nevertheless, she married Hill and moved into his mother's J Street house during the early years of their marriage. She recalled these years as hard but happy. As a profile in the Michigan Chronicle reports, there was a time when she baked cookies and cakes to supplement her husband's salary. They made it a family project, and everyone was happy doing it. The family, Georgia, Reverend Hill, and his mother, were also among the first to take an active interest in selling black newspapers, especially the Detroit Courier. Mother Hill would continue to sell the paper well into old age. Such measures were necessary because in 1920 Hill had also taken on the pastorate of his own congregation with a modest salary. His new church, Hartford Avenue Baptist, at the corner of Hartford and Milford Streets, was in 1920 little more than a wooden shack. Organized in 1917 by Second Baptist, the church was an urban outpost located across Woodward Avenue, a neighborhood into which blacks were slowly beginning to flow. These West Siders, who no longer wished to travel east of Woodward, the broad avenue that once served as the city's racial divider, solicited the aid of Reverend Bradby and Second Baptist, the mother of Hartford, for help in establishing their own congregation. Originally known as the Institutional Baptist Church, Hartford's early membership was made up of people of all faiths, for this was the first church in the area, and was first pastored by Reverend E.W. Edwards, whose salary was paid in part by the Detroit Baptist Union and Second Baptist. In many ways, Hartford was part of Bradby and Second Baptist's uplift effort, but it was Hill who made Hartford his own. He aspired, he once said, to make Hartford a haven of spiritual resources for all the contingencies of life. Sadly, less than a year after the Hills were married, their first child, Lucia, died within a week of her birth. Some 11 months later, however, Charles Jr. was born, followed 15 months later by Georgia Roberta. Within the next several years, Wesley, Lovica, Bermisha, Sylvia, Brent, and Lance Hill were added to the clan. And as Hill's family continued to grow, so too did his church. From a membership of 35 in 1920, Hartford grew by 1926 to one of the 10 largest black churches in the city, with a membership of over 1,200. In part, this impressive growth can be linked to the influx of Southern migrants into the neighborhood, as well as to relationship between Hartford and Second Baptist. But part of the explanation also lies in Hill's quiet charisma and his dedication to outreach and service. Hill initiated an ambitious building project while Georgia came to relish her role as First Lady of Hartford. She was a founding member of the Ladies' Aid Society, served on the Women's Day Committee, and was a steady and dignified presence at most social functions. Once their children were a bit older, she extended her sphere of social involvement, serving on the board of the Lucy Thurman branch of the Young Women's Christian Association, YWCA. She also became an avid club woman. Indeed, her extensive range of memberships led her children to joke that if she did not have a club to join for a particular purpose, then she would surely invent one. And she did help to invent them. Over the years of her marriage, Georgia Hill assisted in organizing the Abetanwa Club for Detroit Ministers' Wives, the Interdenominational Wives Organization, and the Baptist Ministers' Wives Association. Throughout the 1920s, both husband and wife poured their energies into church and family. While forced to live with Hill's mother to make ends meet, the family was still better off than the majority of the church's members.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.